Thanks for joining us today. I'm John Amond. I'm Professor of Chemistry Emeritus at Montana State University. I'm also President of MicroLab. Today I'd like to talk with you about managing chemical samples. Most experiments involve much more than just pouring solutions together and watching. MicroLab has some integrated tools that will help us with sample illumination, it'll help us stir, and help us easily control the temperature of the reaction. I'd like to shift to a list of the top 10 general chemistry lab topics. This is a survey that Steve Brown at the University of Arizona Tucson did a few years ago. The top three listings in this are graphing of laboratory measurements, which you try to have happen almost everywhere you're doing an experiment. Acid-base titrations are next, and then spectrophotometry, Beer's law, and kinetics. These experiments all involve watching or measuring color changes, which means in most cases you need to illuminate your sample. You need to stir when you add a titrant or a reactant to the mixture. And sometimes, especially in kinetics experiments, it's really important to control the temperature. And all of these features work together with MicroLab. Here's a kind of a triangle showing the different parts of an experiment. We have tools to plan and collect and analyze your data. These are software tools. That's the upper right sector. We have tools to make measurements, temperature, pH, light, spectrophotometry, and so forth. And then you have tools to manage your sample. And these are usually separate tools, tools to illuminate, tools to stir, tools to heat, tools to electrical charge on, or something like that. All of these are integrated in MicroLab, and they work off of the same software set. I'd like to start out by looking at illumination. We can manage illumination, and we're going to in a moment switch to look at the top of the MicroLab, and we'll get the software going. Okay, let's look first at sample illumination. MicroLab has four LEDs in the top of its box. Two are white. They provide black backlight for the sample so you can watch its color change. The other two are green and are indicators for stirring time. I'd like to shift to the screen over here, and if you notice in the control section, there's some buttons along the bottom here. There's one that says light. If I click that, I get a dialog box, and I can turn the backlight on, and if you notice, those lights lit up, and I can control its brightness. There are also status lights for timing, stirring during titrations. They're green and red, and you can see those turn on and off. I have here a sample illumination module that I'm going to set up here, and I'll just rotate it. You can see it's got a reflector right here in the back, and I'm going to set it over the vial holder, and you can see it's kind of lit up in back. I can make it brighter by making the lights brighter. I'm going to drop a vial down in there, and if I turn it off, you can see there's a lot of difference in illumination. We've placed a vial with water in it, and you're looking straight down now, and you can see the stir bar on the bottom. There's a magnetic stir motor right underneath the vial, and it's composed of six coils, and it creates a rotating magnetic field. So there's no moving part in the motor. The result of that is you can reverse it anytime you want. We'll show you the value of that in just a second. I'm going to turn the stirring motor on, and I'll turn stirring on. It's set for 4 revolutions per second, and you can see it's rotating there. I can make it reverse if I want. A reversing interval is set every 4 seconds. I'll turn that on. Now watch this. It's going to stop, and then it'll go backwards. And the purpose of that is to break up a vortex and make it mix a lot quicker. Backlighting control is available right here, just as always. We have the vial in an oblique shot at it right now. You can see reflected in the meniscus the stirring bar on the bottom. Now I'm going to start it, and I'm going to do what's called laminar stirring. I'm stirring just in one direction, it will not reverse. And I'm going to put a drop of green food color in this. And you can see right away a vortex forms. And it mixes and mixes, and it takes a while for this vortex to go away. The problem with laminar mixing is that it traps the titrant right in that vortex, and it stays around for a long time. What I'm going to do this time is put a 4-second reversing on it. And what this is going to do is every 4 seconds or so, the stir bar will reverse, and I'm going to put a drop of green food coloring in as before. Watch what happens here. Okay, there it's stirring up. Now, if you watch carefully, it's going to reverse in just a second. See that? And what you get is very rapid mixing, very good quality mixing. In a spectrophotometric titration, at this point, you could stop and shine light through the bottom and see how it absorbed. There's the red and green timer lights allow you to tell when to put the sample in. If you want a 15-second stir, it'll say green, put the sample in, it turns red, and stirs for 15 seconds and then turns green and you're ready to do it again. Okay, now we'd like to shift to temperature. We have a fresh vial of water in this, and I've mounted the electrode holder above it here. There's a heater and a thermistor, which are pretty hard to see, but you can see a little better when I get it turned on. I'm going to turn the heater on right here just a little bit so you can see it. The heater on, it says use the heater, and it says warning, don't run it above 8% unless it's immersed. This is an immersion heater. It's a glass bulb so you can see what's going on. If it's immersed in water, the bulb will never get any hotter than the water and it won't break. Okay, I'm going to lower it down into the liquid. I'm going to turn it off to do that. You can see the light bulb lighting. You can see right beside it, right here, the thermistor that's going to monitor what's going on. It's 28 degrees in that liquid right now, and the heater is on just a little bit. I'm going to turn the heater dialog box on, and let's say I want to run this thing at 36 degrees. So I'll set it at 36. It's got three control modes, proportional, manual, and binary. Binary is on if you're below the target temperature, off if you're above it. Manual, of course, is self-explanatory. And proportional, as you approach the target temperature, the energy applied to the heater goes down. That way you kind of coast right up to where you want. Okay, we're going to set this up. I have set the thermistor up. I have time on the x-axis, thermistor B on the y-axis. I'm going to just check the lighting, the stirring, and the heater. Lighting is running, backlight is on. It's about 14 units. You can see it's slightly backlit. I'll close that. I'm going to turn the stirring on, and the stirring is going, we'll run at about 10 revolutions per second. And I'm not going to reverse this time because the presence of the heater in the middle of that is going to break a vortex. So that should be stirring at this point. We're going to clear that. Now let's turn the heater on. The heater, I'll turn it on here. It's going to run proportionally. I'm going to set a target temperature of 37. Let's give it about 30% power. You can see it coming up. There's 30%. I'll say continue, and we will start it running, and there we move the video over so you can see it. It's running at 27 degrees, and if you watch it, it's stirring and it's heating up. It's 27.3, 27.4, and we'll run this a bit. I think what we'll do is ask Emery, our video guy, to cut a little bit of the middle of this out in a minute, but we're going to let it run till it gets to up above 37 degrees. Okay, this is approaching 37 degrees, and did you notice that the lamp just dimmed? There it dimmed again. As we approach the target temperature, the proportional control reduces the power to the heater, so we ought to just coast right up to 37 degrees. We have about 4/10 of a degree to go. It's getting cooler. And do you notice how straight a line that is? The heat input was very constant right up until just a few seconds ago, when all of a sudden you can see the heat going down and the graph flattening out, and it's coasting up to approach 37 degrees. There it dimmed again. When it gets there, we're going to let it run a little while, and then we're going to stop it and we're going to measure how flat that line is, how stable the temperature is. Okay, we're in now about 470 seconds. I'm going to stop the experiment and let's look at the data and stop it, turn the heater off so it doesn't heat things up. And here's the result for our experiment. The experiment ran about 480 seconds. And you can see it starting here at 27 degrees, it heated up. And then right up here, it reached about 37, and then it's stable. And it's stable from about 300 seconds up till the end. Now, what I'd like to do next is just select a domain on this, and we're going to do two kinds of analysis. I'm going to start at 320 seconds, and I'm going to just draw a box here around the data. And if you look at that, boy, that's pretty darn flat. I'm going to run a curve fit through that, and it's time and temperature, and I'll say OK. And I want to, wow, it's looks like it's drifting up just a little bit. I'm going to put a first order line on it. It's pretty much straight, but look at the slope. The slope is right here. It's 0.0004 degrees per second. That's 0.4 of a degree per second that it's drifting. So basically, it's constant. Now, what I'd like to do is drag this data down into the data table. So I'll put time here, and I'll put temperature here. And it appears to me we got 967 measurements in about 482 seconds. What I'd like to do is go back up here. It flattened out about 330 seconds. So let's go to 330. And what I'm going to do is take the average temperature from 330 on till the end of the experiment. And I'll right click and I'll say OK. Give me the column statistics. And there are 305 data points. The minimum value 36.94, maximum value 37.0. mean 36.97. The standard deviation was 0.0192. It's about 0.02 degrees, 0.02 of a degree, held over a couple minutes there. And it'll keep that basically indefinitely. This is a very, very stable way to control temperature to any target you want, up to about 60 degrees. This one, you could do a body temperature experiment for kinetics, and it'd be right on the money.